one time, and that was so nice. Can you play Gary and I Talk? I'm serious. Can you? Okay, I got 7 pages here. Yeah, we're not going to read. We're just going to help me keep my mind from drifting. So I'm filling in for Dave, who's having an early anniversary celebration with family. And Judy asked him, could you please not do the talk today? The topic is all events are neutral. I would like us to notice that usually when have a talk. There's the speaker and the audience. And it's like a bunch of separate minds. But it's possible that we could have the experience of one mind. One, as Rod calls it, I love Rod's term, local mind. So that we're all thinking together on this topic without any fear that there's going to be anything imposed that's going to radically destroy your life. Or that you're going to want to like, oh yeah, I got to do that. You know, it's just a kind of a neutral place where there's listening and participating in the thought. And that common voice will be focused on the topic, all events are neutral. And the goal, or the approach I'd like to take today would be not to assert that all things are neutral and try that on as a jacket or something, but to explore how it is that we believe otherwise. How it is that we create meaning where it might not exist, where the experience of our daily life might not mean what we think it does. And through exploring the obstacles to the notion that all events are neutral, we might come to experience a little freedom from that. Let's start with this object here. Except for me, no, it's just all of us now. We're perceiving this with our eyes. And all our eyes are doing is seeing reflected light. There's nothing there but reflected light. And that goes to the retina and the back of your head. There's a bunch of nerves that process that image. But what you see is just reflected light. But then association comes in. We name it. A cup or a mug or a blue mug. And now is where the trouble begins. Because now we interpret that thing we've named. And it comes so fast, the thoughts come so fast that most of the time we don't even notice them. Things like, my grandma gave me that cup. That's like the one I lost. I got scalded from drinking a cup, like that. I keep pens in one like that. And the interpretation escalates. You have destroyed my grandmother's love by breaking that mug. Hey, that's a mug I lost. Did you steal it? I'll never drink hot coffee from McDonald's again. I wonder if that old mug has ink in it. And most of the time, I'm having an emotional reaction before I even notice that I was having thoughts. I'm often running. We also have the ability to see that these interpretations are just memories. They just come from past experience. And they don't really have anything to do with the object. The object is just there. Sometimes it helps when I'm spinning out of control emotionally just to remember that I'm perceiving patterns of reflected light. I'm telling the story about that. Time is also like an event. When we're in a hurry, it seems like there's never enough time. For instance, we are late for a meeting and we come to multiple red lights. There's more red lights than usual. And they seem to take longer to change. Or the opposite. After I turn 40, every year seems to go faster. And then, when I'm at that red light, interpreting how the world is against me, why me, and then I catch myself because I'm a spiritual, psychologically sophisticated person. I try to reinterpret this situation, say, oh no, that light's there to calm me down. And that reinterpretation seems to not work very well. I seem to be trying to convince myself that I'm calming down, but I'm still boiling. And it seems that I'm using my misinterpretations to re-misinterpret them. And the thing that got me in trouble will never get me out of trouble. Our buttons the most. People are not events, but our interactions with them are. Some people we like because our interactions are very pleasant. And others we don't like because they always give us an unpleasant. If the reaction that I have, that we have to other people, is anything like our reaction to an object, perhaps we're not really seeing people for what they are, but instead for our interpretations of who they are, based on our past hurts, our desire to protect ourselves from being hurt, future and hurt the present. We may think, here comes so-and-so, or soul is such a pain. So-and-so always does this and that. And I want to defend myself against that. And maybe even in a higher sense, I want to liberate so-and-so from being such a so-and-so. But I think when I do that, I get trapped into believing my story, right? About so-and-so. And when I do that, I don't really see them for what they are, which sometimes is just reflected light, and I go back to reflected light. Oh, reflected light with an attitude. there I go again when I say attitude. So. So when we let our interpretation of anything take over, peace often goes with it. My dad tells this great story of how paranoid his family was. And, you know, paranoid defensiveness is like the story that they're out to get me, they don't understand me, and I better buck up, protect myself. And it's in our family pretty strong, but I see it in the world. I mean, nobody here is paranoid. But this is my dad's story. Growing up at Christmas and other holidays, somebody would say, "Oh, this food is delicious." And the cook would say, "What do you mean by that?" Another example that Dallas was telling me, she works with people with PTSD. And a lot of vets that come back from combat can't go see fireworks shows because the explosions trigger such strong fear and panic. It's tough, to imagine that, being so overwhelmed. And what I'm going to say is not to diminish the strength and pain of that situation, but to examine it from the standpoint of once the emotion of being consumed by fear takes over, it's hard to say, "I got here by thinking." I got here by interpreting, by misinterpreting events that made me afraid and want to defend myself. So when the fireworks are going off and I got to get my gun and start shooting some people to protect my buddies, I'm already lost in a story. And when that happens, sometimes the only way to be is to recognize that I'm insane right now in this moment, and to breathe. To breathe and move and sigh and look at the eyes of the person which I'm judging and say, "That's not who you are. That's not who you are." But then a dog walks, and the dog starts growling. And it looks like it's about to bite me, and I know that if I go off into some metaphysical philosophy about how I'm just interpreting, I might get bitten. So what do? I notice that I'm starting to make myself afraid, and certainly the dog knows that. And I'm building separation between me and that dog, which doesn't allow me to see whether the dog's really going to bite or not. I can't be with that dog as long as I'm in my interpretation about what that dog is going to do based on the past. So I do the best I can to be with the dog, and I think that's kind of what love is, really, just to be with the what is. But I'm not going to go any further into that. My neighbor, who was a kind of a timid, super nerdy guy, we'd be walking home from school every day, and this dog would, out of five kids, attack, come bark at him. None of the rest of us, the dog barked at him. One day, he just tried something. He was walking around the corner, and the dog ran out at him, and he turned and barked at the dog. And the dog just looked at him. Never happened again. So, after people, then we have stories about God. Like, we have to say, this place is not a church. You know, like, my friend who I used to study Native American stuff with says, oh, you're going to go hang out with the Jesus people. I said, well, I would bet that there's not very many people here that would identify themselves as Jesus people. Oh, okay. There's one. But we have so many stories about God, and I would pose that God is a little like our topic, in that everything we can say that God is we can't, it's undifferentiated. God is not differentiated, doesn't have personality, doesn't have value, doesn't say, I have meaning, you know. And what to me is one of the really spectacular things about this group of people, what we are, is we recognize to some degree that we don't want to have an allegiance with a concept of God. You know, we may, at different levels, have a personalized sense of what a deity is, or God, but we're willing to accept that it's not a rigid definition, you know, personality. But we still have I all the time run into personalizing and identifying what I think God is. So, to end, I would like to do a little exercise in deconstructing. We've talked about, thought about how it is that we don't recognize that everything is really neutral. And it's only a possibility to consider, even if I just again say I'm upset and I see something, I go, oh, that's neutral. That's not there. And it's like I'm denying my experience. I believe anyway, look at my experience. Not indulge it, not deny it, be with it, and allow its true nature to reveal itself. So, for deconstruction, we're going to take off our earth suit just a little bit at a time. And experience our undifferentiated selves. And when it's off, we're going to send it to the cleaners. So please close your eyes. And visualize the body. Just sense it. Be with it for a minute. let your skin dissolve. It just turns into tiny little things that disappear and show up at the cleaner. Now visualize your muscles covering everything and the fascia and the connective tissue, all the glands, tendons, everything just goes away. Down you're left with bones, organs, nerves, and brain. Let the bones dissolve. Completely gone. And let the organs dissolve. Let the nervous system, leave that behind. Feel brain and the nerves as though there are some kind of transmitter receiver tuning into the infinite. Now dissolve that too. Something of you is still here. Just be with that something for a little while. Okay, the cleaner called and everything's cleaned up now. Put the nerves and the brain back in. Muscles, fascia, tendons, covered with beautiful skin, and a radiant sense of being refreshed. Thank you for going on this journey with me. Namaste. Thank you, Tom. I'm sorry, I forgot about it.